Make some noise, Richard.
Aye.
Thank you.
That's it.
And let's welcome back.
I guess we can call on you to bring us back to order anytime.
Whatever, if that's tolerable, I guess. That was only one quart of volume, so.
Okay, so I'm starting from somewhere where I was before. So let's start here. So I'm starting from the notion of self-reference, or some form of system where there's a symbol that's pointing to itself. But we're thinking of it as recursion as well. And if it were the Spencer-Brown mark, then instead of going from plus to minus to plus to minus, it would be going from something to nothing to something to nothing to something to nothing. So you can think of that if you want. But at this stage, or the other stage, I could think of unmarked marked, or marked unmarked, or minus one plus one, and plus one minus one, as the two ways to view this discrete oscillation. And I want to make the square root of minus one appear out of this. But that really requires observing a little more about what's going on here, and then adding it into the structure, and then you see it. Because what else is going on here is that there's an operation which is taking you between these two, which is basically permuting these two, or shifting it by one period step. And so I want to include that operation into my language. And so I'm going to do that in the following way. I have pairs, A, B, so I could think of it as not plus minus, but A, B, A, B, A, B, like that. And then I'm going to introduce a shift operator, and that has the property that if it's on one side of the A, B, and you shift it to the other side, then the A, B turns into a B, A. All right? So that's a non-commutative operation. Eta on one side is different from eta on the other. And so it indicates that there was a time shift if you move the eta past. And eta squared is equal to 1 because eta just means switch between A and B, B and A. So we'll add that into the brew, and then we will also allow that you can multiply the waveforms in the more or less obvious way of multiplying them term by term. A, B, C, D is A, C, B, D. So that's like if you had underneath the A, B, A, B, A, B waveform, that was a C, D, C, D, C, D, C, D, and you combine them term by term, either multiplying or adding. And now I is defined by the equation, keep trying to recognize the red dot. The equation is, here's the relegated ambiguity, it's no longer ambiguous, it goes 1 and then minus 1. But then there's the eta, which is the temporal shift operator, which makes this whole thing temporal in the sense that if you interact it with some other AB, it will cause the other AB to shift. And now look at what happens when you interact with them, let them interact, I with I. You have 1 minus 1 eta, 1 minus 1 eta. I push. Either way I care to do it, I can think of pushing this eta to the right and that will cause this one to flip. Or I can think of pushing this eta into the middle and that will cause this one to flip. And eta squared is 1. So either way, if you push it to the right or to the left, this one flips to 1 minus 1 and minus 1, 1, and they combine minus 1. So that formalizes that intuitive idea that you take the ambiguity and you let it interact with itself, and it takes a little bit of time for the ambiguity to happen, and it flips and gives you minus 1. So that's a picture of creating the square root of minus 1, which I've called I here. And then the next slide, I've said it again a little more symbolically. I'm calling E, or sometimes I call it epsilon, the 1 minus 1. And E squared, because you multiply corresponding terms, is 1, 1, which is 1. And eta does that, as we said. So what we have about eta and E is that e squared is 1, eta squared is 1, but e eta is minus a to e. That's because minus e is 1 minus 1. So that's an algebraic way of saying what I just said. E eta is minus a to e. And so this little algebra that comes up is that little Clifford algebra that we talked about before. So the Clifford algebra, the non-commutative, simple non-commutative Clifford algebra, is actually a descriptive algebra of the situation of a simple recursion. So this is re-entry recursion. So, so I found that pleasing that that you can think of Clifford algebra as arising from a recursion, and that the square root of minus one then arises out of that. And the square root of minus one is arising abstractly whenever you have one of these little algebras, because you see e eta is this eta, and when you multiply it by itself, you get minus one. And that's what this does. E eta multiplied by e eta. You flip the eta across the e, it squares to one and goes away, and you get e times minus e, and that's equal to minus one. So that's the Clifford algebra coming up. Okay? So that's a review of something that was in the middle of what I was talking about. And then we were talking about Spencer Brown Mark and how we would think of it as being self-referential. And we talked about eigenforms a little bit. And now let me slow down and talk about another eigenform for a moment. This is the easy eigenform, the one that's easy to think about, although it uses infinity. I can produce a fixed point for anybody. In particular, I can produce a fixed point for, put a box around it. And I do this by iterating, put a box around it forever. So that's what I've indicated here. I have put a box around it forever here, and then if I put one more box around it, it doesn't change it. Or I can take any f whatsoever, and I can apply it to itself infinitely, often formally, and then if you put one more f on there, it's leaving it alone. So any f has a fixed point. But obviously the fixed point that you create when you do that may lie outside of the domain you started with, right? Like if I say, take the sine of the sine of the sine of the sine of the sine forever, it doesn't have a numerical value, right? And box over box over box certainly doesn't have a numerical value, nor is it a finite collection of boxes. So there's another way, which it also takes you outside the box. And in this way, you define f of x, x, letting x act on itself, as though x could act on itself, assuming that x could act on itself. And you define g of x to be f of x, x. And now just take that as a bit of formalism and ask yourself, what will happen if I let x be equal to g? And you see that gg is equal to f of gg. So you got a fixed point. You got a fixed point if you were in a world where things could act on themselves and new things that were constructed, such as g here, were also regarded as part of that world. So I call that a reflexive domain. And this is, the algebra of this is called Lambda calculus. And this can be used to generalize things that are formally paradoxical. I don't think I made a slide of this here, but you could interpret this in the following way, just try it in your head. XG means X belongs to G. All right? XG means X belongs to G. XX then means what? If GX means X belongs to G, then what does XX mean?
X belongs to X.
X belongs to X, right? So suppose that F is not, tilde, not. Then this G would have the property that X belongs to G means that it is not the case that X belongs to X. The Russell set. So that defines the Russell set. And then if I take x equal to g and ask, does the Russell set belong to itself? It becomes equal to, it is not the case that the Russell set belongs to itself. And that's the Russell paradox. So the Russell paradox appears as a fixed point for negation. Negation is not supposed to have a fixed point in ordinary logic, because the negation of true is false and the negation of false is true, and there are only two values in ordinary logic. So the Russell set could live in a larger logical domain. But that's another way of creating fixed points. Well, enough said about fixed points. Then there was the laws of form, and I reminded you of it again, that these equations really are self-referential. This is thinking of one of them as the name of the other. And then it doesn't matter if the name is next to the object stands on its own. And this one is a kind of nilpotency, which says that if you cross from the marked state, you end up in the unmarked state, where this one takes the role of name, and this one takes the role of action. And if you take the action of crossing from the marked state, you end up unmarked. And then this becomes a place where you can do logic. If you haven't seen this before, that's what it was invented for, partly anyway. That you can think of this one symbol as being the value true or false, and you can also think of it as the negation operator, which changes true to false. And so you can translate it into ordinary logic. And the translation is, this is the negation, this is or, that's implication, and this is and. And on the other hand, it looks like a single particle that can interact with itself in two ways. And we were talking about that and comparing it to a Majorana particle. So I'm still reviewing a little bit, but that's where we were. And it's at this point that this remark makes some sense to make, because you see that in the laws of form system, the mark is part of the world in which it's acting, even symbolically. It's part of its own symbolic world, whereas in ordinary logic, the negation is not part of the values of the logic. It's separate from the values. So whether or not you're talking about the external world or the world of the logic itself, the mark has crossed the boundary into the world of the logic by means of Spencer Brown's trick, if it is a trick, or understanding that you can think of it as a distinction. So that's still revealing the same things in a slightly different way. And then we talked about the Majorana fermion, and I'm sure you remember this, but maybe this part is a little mysterious and we could talk about it a little bit, this part here. What I meant was that the rules for this particle are that it interacts with itself in two possible ways. One way, it gets itself back, like Mark makes to Mark. And the other way, it annihilates itself, like that. And then this star acts like one, an identity element. One times p is p, and one times one is one. And then I write p squared equals p plus star, and that means that it's either p or it's star, right? So then I said it looked like the Fibonacci equation, right? The x squared equals x plus 1. But you can think of that in terms of the self-interaction of that particle. And there was a piece of paper here. Oh, here it is, yeah. So let's take a look at that for a moment, just so we can have a little fun with it. So I know that p squared is p plus star, which gives me the distribution of possibilities, and p should interact with itself, right? That's what I'm thinking about. Now, what will happen if I let it interact with itself three times? I have three of them, and I let them interact. Well, you have p and p and p, right? And that means that these two can interact to produce a star, and then you would have p star. But another thing that could happen is that these two would interact to produce a star, and then you would have a p, right? So, you see, there are different interactions that can happen. But I'm cataloging them all by just multiplying along. So this is the same as p squared plus p star, right? Just multiplying along. And then p squared, why p squared is p plus star. And p is p, p star is p. So So you see I have two P and one star. So that, those are the things that can happen if you take three of them and multiply and let them interact. You could get two ways of getting P and one way of getting star, just one way of getting star, only one. But there are two ways of getting P. I showed you the two ways of getting P, and the one way to get star is that any two of them interact to give you a star, and then it interacts with the third one, gives you with three, the only way to get a star in the end would be that two P's interact to give you a P, and then the two P's give you a star, right? That's the only way it can happen. So that's what happened with PQ. Then P to the fourth. P to the fourth is 2P squared plus P star. So now I get 2 times P plus star plus P, which is 3P plus 2 star. And now you see, with P to the fourth, I can get 3 P's and 2 stars. And with P to the fifth, I'm going to get 5 P's and 3 stars. And the Fibonacci numbers are coming up that way. You see, those are the Fibonacci numbers. You're going to get Fibonacci number times 1 and Fibonacci number times the other.
That's no miracle, that's
what?
That's no miracle, that's just the fact that you're...
No, it's no miracle.
Adding on 1.
It's just coming out of a recursiveness.
Yeah. Come out of anything that will occur.
Yeah, that's right. And if you wanted to play with it a little more, you could do it over one hand. One can say, all right, actually I'm interested in letting them interact in a very specific way. So I'm going to have a number of them, and I'm going to have these interact first, then this one, and then this one, right? So this could be a star or a P. Let's say it's a star. And then it interacts with P and produces a P. And then it interacts with P and maybe produces a P. But you see that in these sequences that are happening here, there will never be two stars in a row, because if you get a star, it'll be interacting with a P coming from the top, and that will give you a P. So you have all sequences of stars and P's where a star only occurs once at a time, and you can check for a Fibonacci number of them. So that's another way of thinking about it. Okay, so the Fibonacci numbers are implicit in the structure of this very elementary particle. And that's fun and important when you're trying to count things about it. And then we talked about this. I remind you from the bottom of the slide up what this was about, that if I have our favorite little Clifford algebra, a squared equals b squared equals 1, and ab equals minus ba, now written in ab, and I form complex combinations of that with an I, then I get two operators that are nilpotent. So this is a source of nilpotence. If you wanted to get nilpotence quickly, if you felt that the nilpotents are important and you should get to them, one way to get to them is exactly this, you see, because when you multiply that by itself, what will happen? You get a squared, you get minus b squared, a squared minus b squared is 0. And then you get ab and ba and times I, and ab plus ba is 0. So intercommutativity and square 1 give you nilpotence. And conversely, if you start with anticommutativity and square, if you start with nilpotent in the sense of this, then you get to anticommutativity and square 1. So Clifford algebra and nilpotence here are very close, right on top of one another. It's just a question of which way you care to tell the story. If you're I'm telling a story where the anticommutativity seems to come up first, but that's an artifact of my story. Maybe you like my story, maybe you like another story. And then we talked about how that seems to say that an electron, which is what psi and psi dagger represent, electron and positron, that they're composed of, in some sense, these Majorana particles. And let's pretend that way. And look at Majorana particles for a little while. So now, in this slideshow, as I was drawing, I wrote this set of notes trying to get all the points that I was vaguely thinking about down on paper. And so some of them you've already seen, and you can skip them quickly. This you've already seen. And this you've already seen, but here it is again, written in the epsilon, right? In the epsilon way. That I squared, if you take I to be epsilon eta, epsilon eta, epsilon eta. But when epsilon eta turns around, and then in the middle, it becomes eta epsilon, which is eta bar epsilon, eta bar being minus eta. Switching the language around a little bit. Bar means switch the signs or switch the order. and eta epsilon epsilon bar is minus one because it's the thing that gives you minus one. And eta squared is one. So this is that thing again. There's our Clifford algebra. And I like to say to myself, the Clifford algebra is a process algebra associated with the self-reference of the mark. But if you have a favorite other interpretation of the Clifford algebra that you think of as fundamental, then put yours in there instead. I'm just pointing out that you can tell different stories, and the story that I was interested in here is starting with a kind of semiotic consideration of self-reference and finding the Clifford algebra right next to it, that way. Now, there's matrix algebra, and it's important to stop and look at that a bit. If you want a translation to standard algebra, it exists perfectly naturally. The AB without an eta corresponds to the diagonal entries of a 2x2 matrix, and the eta corresponds to the anti-diagonal. So eta itself is 0, 1, 1, 0, which is a permutation matrix applied to a vector that permutes the two coordinates. Epsilon is the diagonal matrix, which is 1 and minus 1. And of course, epsilon times epsilon gives you 1, 1, gives you 1. But epsilon eta, when you multiply it out, puts the 1 and the minus 1 on the anti-diagonal. And there is a well-known entity, which is often thought of as the matrix version of the square root of minus 1. And the alternation between 1 and minus 1 is sitting there on the anti-diagonal. So this all fits directly into standard algebra. And so we have our little Clifford algebra then in 2x2 matrices. This, 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 and this. No appearance of any complex numbers here, right? Just 2x2 matrices, or just iterants. And this is often called the split quaternions, because you have this is squared to 1 and 1, and this one is squared to minus 1. So we don't have enough things that square to minus 1, but this one is the product of these two, and if you put them in the right order, they multiply each other cyclically like quaternions do. So there you could think of them as pre-quaternions, if you like. And how would we make quaternions out of that? Well, here's my favorite answer to that. You start with these guys, here, 1, epsilon, eta, epsilon, eta. And you introduce a brand new I that commutes with all of them. So this is that I that Peter uses also, that commutes with everybody. And we're going to call that one I, and we're going to keep epsilon, eta as a guy that has square minus 1, but it's not I anymore. I is the one that commutes with everybody. And now I can create things with square minus 1. I call I epsilon. I squared is minus 1, and epsilon squared is 1. So this has minus 1 squared. J is epsilon eta, and all by itself manages to square to minus 1. K is I eta, and all by itself, with the help of I, squares to minus 1. And now you see I times J, well, we have, there's an epsilon sandwiched in the middle that goes away, and you get I eta, that's K. JK is epsilon eta. I commutes, and you get eta squared is 1, so you just get I epsilon back here. And KI, that's the most interesting one, K times I, gives me I eta I epsilon. I squared is minus 1. Eta epsilon, minus eta epsilon, but it anti-commutes, so it gives you epsilon eta. And there's J. So here's your quaternions. Okay? So quaternions naturally occur by sprinkling the right square roots of minus 1 on the Clifford algebra, and the split quaternions transform into the quaternions, and there they are, from an algebraic point of view. So if somebody says, I'm using the quaternions, and you're thinking, well, what about that person who was doing Clifford algebras? You can just translate them back and forth like that if you want. Now, when I start talking about the Dirac equation in a minute or two, I will, in fact, use epsilon and eta and track that I and to see why in a little bit. But let's talk about the quaternions a little bit more. Consider this famous matrix. This matrix is a complex number z, z bar, w, and minus w bar. And as you see, it's a plus bi plus cj plus dk, where those are my I, j, and k. You think of them as 2x2 matrices. But this is, if you take the case where the determinant is 1, and the determinant is a squared minus b squared plus c squared minus d squared. So it's equal to the sum of the squares of the absolute values of those complex numbers. That's the group SU2. So the quaternions of unit length is the same as the group SU2 in matrices. And then there are other departures that people take. For example, some people like to make this into 4x4 matrices by letting the I be 0, 1, minus 1, 0, a little 2x2 block, and the A would be A times the identity, 1x1 block, or 2x2 block. You boost the whole thing into a 4x4 matrix. You can, if you want to. So this is how this fits into the quaternions in various ways. Now, I'm probably going to skip some slides here, but let's not skip this. Let's talk about this. This is the topology part, but I wanted to talk about the Dirac equation part, so I'm a little torn. I don't want to do both, but I'll do a little of this. Suppose I have a row of my fermions. Then I'm going to show you that they, and you could imagine a row of Majorana fermions from a row of electrons. You have a row of electrons and you think of each electron as two Majorana fermions, and then you have a row of Majorana fermions. And then some people in Delft over the last couple of years and some other people, Princeton and elsewhere, have looked at correlations between the ends of rows of electrons in nanowires, and they find that the correlations fit with the theory that you could think of the electrons as Majorana fermions. So there's some evidence that Majorana fermions make sense as the thought of a particle. But I say a thought of a particle because they're much farther from being observed as particles in any individual way than, say, a quark. In the case of quarks, you can scatter protons and get some evidence that there looks like inside the protons something smaller scattering. But I don't think there's any chance at the moment of seeing anything like a Majorana fermion. But you have a row of Majorana fermions. And then you're like, oops, the anti-commute. So we're now just thinking mathematically about them. And I want you to notice this element here, AK, which is CK plus 1 times CK. AN is C1 times CN, going cyclically around as though they were in a circle, right? And I take the next one times the previous one. And this, of course, has square one, just like E eta has square minus one, right? You multiply it by itself, anti-commute these two, and now you have two guys that are squaring to one, and that's all that's left in a minus sign. So these all square to minus one. And then, so that's sort of like quaternions. And then you have AKAL, a commute, if they're far apart. Yeah, that situation. And you can see that they commute by just watching these indices here. I won't bother you with it. And in fact, if you took three of them, C1, C2, C3, and you did this, C2, C1, C3, C2, and C1, C3, you have the quaternions. Again, another way of making the quaternions. You can make the quaternions directly out of three Majorana fermions without having to introduce an extra I, if you want to. So now here's the remarkable thing. That if you define this guy, a mathematical kind of guy, where is the... this guy. 1 plus AK divided by root 2. Then these people satisfy braiding operations. They commute when they're far apart. And when they're near one another, they do the sigma k plus 1, sigma k equals sigma k plus 1, sigma k plus 1dance. That's this dance. A little braid next to another little braid, one step over, next step back. is the same as the first grade, step over, step back, step over. 1-2-1 versus 2-1-2. K, K plus 1, K versus K plus 1, K, K plus 1. And you see this is a topological move. The line going all the way down from left to right is going over everything. This crossing can be shifted upward, and that one downward a little bit, and these are topologically the same. The basic gradient move that generates the break group. And the question is, why is this working, and what is that about? So, to see that it works, you need to note that, as I said, each of these AKs that I described as square minus one, and I'm going to observe the following. They anti-commute with one another. We'll just go through this quickly, but watch it, you'll see. These AKs anti-commute. I think you should check that yourself. They do. If you then multiplied this one by AK on the right, AK squared is minus 1, you would get AK, AK plus 1, AK, and change the sign, AK plus 1. And AK plus 1, AK, AK plus 1 is AK. It looks a little like gradient, but you see what it says is K, K plus 1, K gives you the K plus 1, gives you the one in the middle. K plus 1, K, K plus 1 gives you the one in the middle. Yeah.
If you rotate the second one,
endpoints are fixed. Endpoints are fixed. I'm not rotating.
180 degrees, they become the same.
Yes, but that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying, where's those nice strings of NPs? Can I have three? Or two, because I have one here.
So if you go
it's not a rotation that I'm talking about.
Yes, but what does
that mean? Well, you're right, of course, that a rotation will do it, but that's not my problem. So now all I'm saying is the following. That if I twist this one, and then I twist this one, and then I twist this one back here, like that,
yes.
That is topologically the same as if I were to push this over a little bit, like that. And I'm not rotating anything, I'm just sliding the strings, okay? And the whole braiding idea is that you would do things with the strings, like I might make a braid, like this. And then I'll do it for a little while so you can see the weave that I'm creating. I'm going to create a bit of a weave, right? And then a weave like that, I hold the ends top and bottom, and I have a topological entity. If I have another braid, then I multiply it by the other braid by attaching them end to end. So I'm not rotating them around so much as looking at how the strings move when the ends are held fixed.
Yeah, but my point was that if you put the one upside down, then they kind of overlap.
Yeah, right.
And that's a kind of diagrammatical proof instead of an algebraic proof.
Well, as I said to you, the constraint that I'm talking about here for braiding is that the endpoints are fixed, so I don't get to rotate. My rules are that the endpoints are fixed. Just like if I'm braiding someone's hair, and I do the braiding, go on, braid, and then I get these endpoints. And maybe I put a little device with holes in it, and tie it to hold the braid, right? And then the endpoints are fixed here and they're fixed there. I might also consider rotating the whole braid, but that's a different story, okay?
Okay.
So anyway, here's the story, better illustrated. All I need to see what is doing the braiding is this much here. I have the anti-commuting algebra. Now I'm in anti-commuting algebra and squares are minus one. And if you have this, then you have ABA equals B, and BAB equals A, because A squared equals minus one, just multiply on the right, and you get that. And then I'm claiming that sigma A and sigma B will braid one another, and you can see it algebraically by just multiplying it out, and it works in a few lines. It's still mysterious, but it works in a few lines. I will not drag you through the lines, but it's, there's no more needed to verify than to just play with this little bit of algebra here, and you get the braiding. So that non-trivial braiding is associated with the Clifford algebras. I think I have a better illustration. This is saying the same thing. This shows you a little something. Because this is what I'm saying, that you have the Majorana fermions, you can think of exchanging them. And if you think of them, as people sometimes think about fermions by playing with belt trick, let's use this for the belt trick. So I have two strands here. Never mind what's outside. That's harder to see. Let's do this one. So I have the two particles, and I exchange them, thinking of them as attached to one another by strings. Then they acquire a 360-degree twist between them. So there's some evidence of their braiding happening in the topological space. The braiding of the two particles, exchanging them, causes a little twist to happen in between them. If you look at the mathematics of what I was just doing before, and represented in a certain way, which I'm not going to do, I'll just leave it out, then you find that the mathematics simplifies. It isn't all of the mathematics, it's a significant part of it. And the way it simplifies is that instead of having that complicated formula that I had before, it amounts to that this fermion will turn into that one, but this one will turn into minus that. And that minus corresponds to the twist in the belt, formally. So that the fermion, these little Majoranas in a row, do braid one another, and they braid one another according to a rule which is related to the belt trick applied to each one, and that's the way they work. Now that braiding, and maybe a more complicated version of the braiding that I already showed you with the A's and the B's, is underlying what happens with fermions. So the question is, what is really going on with that topology and fermions? And I don't know the answer.
Can I insist on
yeah.
It's, for instance, if instead of having it on the screen there, you have the braids, the two braids on the floor. And if you not rotate the braids, you yourself turn around them, then you see the same thing. According to the position you are looking at.
Yes, we know you do, and it's that's the same. That's the same
let me
finish, and then I'm going to cut you off because I need more time.
Okay.
The thing that's interesting here is that the belt trick only says there's a twist on the belt. This mathematics related to the fermions tells you that one of them gets the twist, not the other. That isn't apparent if you're just doing geometry with the belt.
My point was that if you imagine somebody going around, you put the subject in.
Yes.
And that was the interesting point.
Yes.
In
the belt trick, the subject is connected with the object by a topological line. And then the subject and the object interaction is indicated by the topology of the belt in a quaternionic way.
Okay.
So it's very interesting.
Okay.
I wasn't going to talk about the belt trick in a lot of detail, but that's related to this, where this is a kind of multiple and highly organized belt trick that occurs with these rows of particles. This I skipped. There's something called Temporally-Leib algebra, which has a very similar relation, and I was going to talk about it, but I skip it. Okay. The relation looks similar. This is the one we had before, the first one that gives rise to braiding. The other one looks the same. PQP equals P. It's not the same. ABA equals B. PQP equals P. P on the outside. Q on the outside. This one comes from a different kind of geometry, but it's also topological. The kind of geometry it comes from is this. Here's the P. It's like a drop, cat drop, and a line. And the Q is a shifted one. And when you multiply P by itself, it squares and gives you a little loop. When you multiply P and Q and P, you get P and Q and P, so you're sort of gradient. But this line in the middle is topologically straightenable. You get P back, the outside one, and Q back. And then this also gives rise to grading. It's related to grading. But we're skipping the details of that. That's interesting, but we're skipping it. So summarizing this part, we have that Majorana fermions are the simplest particles in this sense. They look like Spencer Brown Mark. They're related to the self-interaction of the Spencer Brown Mark with itself, the recursion. They're related to temporal heat, but I'm not talking about that. They certainly suggest a lot of things. And one thing that they suggest that I thought was interesting is to worry about the quantum Hall effect in relation to Majorana fermions. Now, I don't think anybody's analyzed this. The quantum Hall effect is, people have analyzed the quantum Hall effect. You have a plate with a current going through it, usually at very low temperature, and an in a magnetic field. You have a constant current going across the plate this way and a magnetic field this way. And you watch how electrons drift across the plate in a perpendicular direction. Well, the electromagnetic field causes vortices of electrons to happen in the plate, like this. Those vortices tend to have to be filled up in order to move forward. And there are relationships between how full they are and how much they move forward and the current going transverse ends up being quantized. That's what Klitzing originally discovered. And that's called the quantum Hall effect. And then there are variations and fine tunings of it. If you think that the electrons are actually made of Majorana fermions and look at that in relation to this effect, maybe you understand something more. But I don't know if people have crossed those two areas of theory. End of that part of the talk.
Thank you.
Now, I'm skipping that. I want to talk about the Dirac equation for a little bit, and then we'll talk about quaternions. So, the Dirac equation, some of this repeats what Peter said in one way or another. I'm using one coordinate of momentum and one coordinate of mass and one coordinate of energy. So I'm in one space, one time. And the relativistic relationship, if h bar and c are equal to 1, is e squared equals p squared plus m squared. We can come back and ask why that's true. And when you want to do quantum theory, you have corresponding operators, which in the units I just described are the energy operator is id by dt, the momentum operator is minus id by dx, it's only one x, and you're looking for psi so that energy applied to psi will be e psi, an eigenvalue, and p applied to psi will be p psi. Let me give you an example of such a thing, if it's on the slide. It could be more prominently displayed than this, but just look at the e to the I px minus et, just reminding you. If you differentiate this with respect to t, you get what? Minus I e times that thing. So that's what I was just saying, that if I multiply by I, then I get e. And if I differentiate with respect to x, then I get p times I, and if I multiply that by minus I, I get just p. So that's what I was saying, that I can get energy and momentum as eigenvalues out of differentiating away like that. Yeah? All right. So Dirac confronted the problem of that energy squared is p squared plus m squared. You would like to get a square root for it. And if you wrote it as alpha p plus beta m and squared it, not being prejudiced about alpha and beta commuting with one another, and collected the terms, then you see you get this guy here. You get alpha squared and beta squared times b squared and m squared, and you get alpha beta plus beta alpha. So all would work nicely if alpha squared was 1, beta squared was 1, and alpha beta plus beta alpha is equal to 0. And there is the Clifford algebra again, the fundamental of the Clifford algebra, popping up. So that says that I can write down my equation by saying, all right, I'll take the energy operator to be equal to alpha momentum operator plus beta m. M itself is the mass operator. So then, energy applied to psi equals momentum applied to psi times alpha plus beta times m times psi. And this little operator here is the Dirac operator in that dimension. And the Dirac equation takes the form O applied to psi is equal to 0. Okay? Just proceeding in the usual way because I want to connect it up. All right, so here's our Dirac operator. And now let's see what happens when I apply it to the wave. And you see I get E minus alpha P plus beta M. Those times the wave. The minus instead of the plus because we pulled it over to that side. But then here's the beautiful observation, which is basically this observation. Multiply it by beta alpha, the product of the two generators of the Clifford algebra, and you see what happened. You get now beta alpha E and beta P and alpha M. They switched. Some signs changed. But this is still a square root of P squared plus M squared. But this guy squares to minus 1. And these guys anti-commute with one another. So when you square this, this guy becomes minus E squared. This becomes plus P squared plus M squared. And all the other terms go away because they anti-commute. And you're a nilpotent. And there's the nilpotent. The nilpotent is up to a little multiple what the Dirac equation gives you when you differentiate it once by the Dirac operator. So if you multiply the Dirac operator by beta alpha, you get a new operator, and that operator will pull down exactly the nilpotent, and then if you differentiate it one more time, it will give you 0, so that the nilpotent multiplied by the wave gives you a solution to the Dirac equation. Okay? Same story, written in Clifford algebra form. The next part that I'm going to talk about will be in the other slides, because I wanted to show you what happens with the antiparticle and how it's related to the Majorana's, but I've only indicated it on this slide, so I'll just go on. While I'm at it, I'm trying to think about why are nilpotents important, and how did this trick work? It's a very remarkable algebraic trick, right? That you can combine the energy and P in a slightly different way so that it still anti-commutes and gives you something that's squared 0 instead of E squared equals P squared plus M squared. So on this slide I happen to have written, and you can just glance or get the slides later if you want, that I've just written why it is that E squared equals M squared C squared plus P squared C squared, the whole thing. Because E is equal to the relativistic mass, m divided by the square root formula, and p is equal to the relativistic momentum. And it's out of those, playing with the algebra, that you get the Pythagorean relationship. And as we said, you can get the square root. So we can say that the square root of e squared is epsilon p plus a to m. That's one way of putting it, right? Just trying to think about this. In the spirit of the square root of minus 1. This is the square root of e squared. It's not equal to the square root of e numerically, right? It's not e anymore, right? I'm staying away from the operators. So then, here's that whole Dirac development again, and I think I want to just put your attention on what happened when I did it. This is standard Dirac, not modified operator. and I differentiated, and what I got was E minus the square root of E squared times psi. That's what we got, right? The square root of E squared being that imaginary quantity. And in some sense, they should be close. And they become so close that they become nilpotent if you multiply them by the right god, namely epsilon eta. Multiply by epsilon eta, that was the alpha beta. And it becomes the nilpotent. The squares to minus one, this is the right thing, and they all anti-commute. So the nilpotent comes about by remeasuring this difference, which really ought to be very small. But it becomes extremely small, so small that its square is equal to zero. That's one way of thinking about the nilpotent, trying to think about the nilpotent. Then getting back to the general framework has then become what in this form? That, that this thing here really contains all of the code for the fermion. It's an abstract pre-geometric code or operator for the fermion. And this part here is holding the part about the space as continuous space and time. And they've been separated at this level. As soon as you start looking for complicated solutions to the Dirac equation, you'll be getting superpositions of these things, and they won't be so separated. But at this fundamental place, they're separated. And you can think of this as the answer to how do I encode in a quantum way the fermion? And this is a sort of more complicated answer to the question, same question, where you included a continuum background for everything. But there's no need for a continuum background here, and you can construct spaces as you like conceptually. And I think that that's part of a discussion we could have about what is meant by the spaces that Peter talks about. The spaces that Peter talks about live over here more than they do in the combination, it seems to me. You build the spaces on the level of the algebra before you put in the space-time continuum. Yeah. So then here we are, and we modified the operator, and we can create solutions with beta being the nilpotent. So here's our fermion. So I'm going to, at least in speech, identify this with the fermion. And then I have this reflection, which is what I started to say a little bit, that you can think of infinitesimals as being nilpotents. And in fact, you do when you do Grassmann algebra, for example, to give a familiar example, dx. Dx squared is zero. Dx dy is minus dy dx, and dx plus dy squared is equal to zero. These little infinitesimals are nilpotents. So why not think about, and I'll come back to this, why not think about the nilpotents that are arising here as fermions as somehow being nilpotent infinitesimals. Then they live in a realm below the ordinary realm, right? They're in the infinitesimal realm. So maybe you can think of a micro world on the mathematical side that way. I'm playing with analogies. Now the other thing I wanted to show you here in this algebra is what happens if I take the antiparticle. Now here's the fermion, and if I reverse time, then I get a minus sign here. So here's the antiparticle. Now let's take beta plus beta beta. And you see they cancel here, and I get twice this stuff here. Twice the square root of e squared. It's twice the square root of e squared. And when I square it, I get the square of twice the square root of e squared, which is 4e squared. But the e squared is zero, so this is beta beta plus beta plus beta. And so you see I get beta beta plus beta equals constant. And that's the fermion algebra that I was talking to you about before, right? That's exactly fermion algebra. So fermion algebra is coming out of this. It isn't something that came to you on high from some page in a quantum field theory book. It is what happens with a fermion. A fermion has a fermion algebra, and it satisfies those relations. And since it satisfies those relations, it has Majorana fermions associated with it, namely beta plus beta dagger over 2, and beta minus beta dagger over 2i, just as before. And what do they turn out to be? Well, one of them turns out to be the square root of e squared, one of the square roots of e squared, and the other one turns out to be an epsilon eta multiplied by an i, on my design, but it's just squares to E squared. So they're both square to E squared, and they anti-commute. And they separated the energy into one, and the momentum and P and M into the other. And of course, they give rise to the same thing, because P squared plus M squared is equal to E squared, so they're interrelated with one another because of the relativity. And that's the Majorana fermion that comes out of this, if you're using the nilpotent representation. So I thought that was very nice and neat and interesting, and brings us back around to close most of the things that I'd said in terms of nilpotents. But there's a couple of problems left. Let's do everything in three now. So that's not hard. You're going to have three components of momentum, and the E squared looks like this with the sum of the squares. And the energy operator is going to be written in terms of alpha, three alphas and a beta. And the alpha squared should all be equal to 1, and the beta squared should be equal to 1, and they all anti-commute. Everything will work the same. That's a larger Clifford algebra. E is still given this way, and the NP is given this way as operators. And the Dirac equation is this. And it has a bunch of I's in it because of the I's for the P's. An I for E and three I's for the P's, and no I for the beta M. And I'll multiply the whole thing by minus I and shift it so it has just one I on the beta M. Okay? And that's a Dirac equation, a standard Dirac equation. Right? And now we would like to find operators for the standard Dirac equation. And one perfectly good solution is to, and this is the same as Peter's, only I'm doing it Clifford algebra-wise instead of quaternion algebra-wise. I'm using square one quantities. So I have an epsilon and an eta out here, and I have a dual commuting copy of the Clifford algebra, which I've written in hats, epsilon hat, p hat. Epsilon eta, p hats are the operators, sorry. But the epsilon hat and the eta hat are a separate little Clifford algebra. And I need an I here because everybody should have square one. So I finally had to get an I into the situation, the commuting I. I don't seem to be able to do without it. And then this works fine. There's separate algebras. This one has the right square and everything works. And you get this. And then you get, when you differentiate, you get something, and when you multiply by the epsilon eta, it all works out. Get nilpotent exactly as before. That's what Peter was telling you. I'm just writing it in Clifford rather than in quaternion. But the reason I'm writing in Clifford is because I wanted to show you what happens with Majorana's idea. Now, Majorana had the idea that he would like to set up a Dirac algebra, alphas and betas, in such a way that the Dirac operator didn't have any I's in it at all, so that these guys here each represent a 2x2 matrix, and these would be intensors of 2x2 matrices, 4x4 matrix Dirac algebra. But you don't want any I's anywhere because you're hoping to have real solutions, solutions that could correspond to particles that are the same as their antiparticles. And what essentially Majorana discovers is that he can do that if he uses this operator. And you see what he does is he has two copies again, but they're mixed up. The ones that are dealing with the momentum use both parts of the algebra, not just one part of the algebra. When before, with a simpler one, we had one algebra deals with the momentum and then it's multiplied by an element of the other algebra. Here it's mixed in this way. And the beta is already multiplied by I, so that when it gets multiplied by I again, it loses the I, and in the Dirac equation, it's all real. That's Majorana's solution. So the square root of E squared in Majorana's form is like that. Now what happens is, you say to yourself, well, maybe I could multiply by something, that by something and turn it into a nilpotent. I mean, that's what we did before, right? We took this guy and we multiplied E minus this by something to make it into a nilpotent. Well, I don't know how to do it anymore. That's my problem. I could be wrong, but it looks like restricting to this much algebra, at least, I can't turn it into a nilpotent in any obvious way. So that when you go Myorama's route, you seem to have dropped out of the Milpoten situation. That could be an indication that Myorama is going the wrong route. Or it could be an indication that it would be very interesting to change the algebra in some way to get a Milpoten, but that's a problem that I run into, but I wanted to tell you about it. Okay. I see this is running over, but well, I wanted to say two more words about infinitesimals. If I start with a nilpotent infinitesimals, star squared equals zero, then I can do calculus in the following way. F of x plus star, that's a displacement, minus f of x, shall be equal to the derivative of f multiplied by the nilpotent. To convince you that this is calculus, take x squared, and we have x plus star squared, minus x squared is x squared plus 2x star plus star squared minus x squared. X squared cancel, star squared is 0, 2x star, and 2x is the derivative of x squared. Okay? You can develop all of calculus this way. It's very nice. Much better than what we usually do when we teach calculus. But you have to convince people that they should deal with strange things like nilpotent infinitesimals in order to teach it. So that's this version of calculus. Now, this is related to non-standard logic in the following sense. I could say not A equals B is means A is not equal to B. I can say not A is not equal to B to mean A is indistinguishable from B. Which doesn't mean that A is equal to B. If I say it is not the case that A is not equal to B, I just mean that A is indistinguishable from B. It doesn't mean A is equal to B. All right? And then I can talk about the infinitesimal neighborhood of zero to be the set of X such that X is indistinguishable from zero. And then I would like models. And here's a model where the star squared of zero infinitesimal lives in there, and the neighborhood of zero is the set of multiples of star. And of course, the things that are indistinguishable from zero are infinitesimal. They aren't standard real numbers, they're infinitesimal.
Oh, okay.
So then you get nilpotents, of course, you get the difference function f hat minus f is always a nilpotent, right? So this space is full of nilpotents, and it's also full of some non-standard logic when you try to deal with it correctly. And then we could do one further step, and this is just an idea. I'm going to do the following. I'm going to take f hat minus f is f prime star x. There's a nilpotent, but I'm also going to have an operator like the eta, which shifts it by one time step. So that fj is the same as j f hat f is f of x plus star. So it says j inverse fj is f hat. And then you see that says that f prime star is j inverse fjf. In other words, j inverse commutator of f of j. So the derivative is given by the commutator up to this algebra of the j. And you have j f prime star is fj, the commutator. And that means that the commutators that represent derivatives are nilpotent. And so you're going to have a non-commutative world in which there are representatives for all the different nilpotent elements of all the fermions as directional derivatives, covariant derivatives, that don't necessarily commute with one another if the corresponding fermions don't commute with one another, so that the curvatures in the non-commutative world correspond to the properties of the fermions. So this may be a canvas on which one could study nilpotents, and I'm just playing with the idea. Like in the case of the one we were looking at, there's a commutator relation as well as a plus mutator relation. And so those two derivative directions would not commute with one another. And you would have them conceptualized as curvature. So that actually is more or less the end of the talk. I have a slide here about non-standard algebra, about hiding algebra, which is the kind of intuitionistic logic that I was talking about before. but it's too much, so we'll stop here, other than showing you the slide.
The differentiation you're defining, is it discrete? So if it's discrete?
Yeah, so what kind of discrete differentiation am I doing now? I'm shifting by one infinitesimal, which is a kind of discrete differentiation, so, right? It's not by a finite amount, it's by an infinitesimal amount, but I'm still not taking a limit.
So if that's the case, could that be a possible reason why it's blocking the solution of the continuous mass, that you were trying to find for the nilpotent expression? Remember you said the problem you were trying to find?
Now, remember I went down a certain track. I said Majorana tried to do this special thing, right? Get rid of the I. And then he finds that he can do it, but then the algebras mix with one another. The two algebras that are regarded by Peter as separate spaces, they mix with one another in some funny way. And then you would expect that maybe all hell breaks loose or something goes wrong. Well, something goes wrong from the point of view of nilpotence. It doesn't seem to produce a nilpotence. But that doesn't mean that it's wrong or that nilpotents are wrong. It just is a problem to understand what happened there.
In the nilpotent structure analysis, you could treat one of the brackets as one space and the other bracket as the other, as it were. So the differentiation thing is acting on the phase factor. That's all about vacuum, really. And the other one, the amplitude factor, is all about the local particle. Mm-hmm. You could regard them as two separate spaces.
Well, that's an amplitude.
Together they become nilpotent. Each is nilpotent because each requires the other.
And I remember you were saying something like it would be resolved if the mass was brought back in because the mass is continuous.
No. I don't remember saying that, but I may have done it. What I did say in that you've got up there is that if you did that discrete differentiation based on commutators, that method of discrete differentiation, then the...
Well, that's another, yeah. Now, you have some interesting remarks about discrete differentiation, which need to be compared with this, but I haven't thought about it.
Yeah, can you give me a copy of this one?
Yeah.
The mass term disappears in the operator.
That's what
it's retained in the amplitude.
Right,
I remember that.
So you don't need the I at all in the operator, but you need it in the amplitude.
Well, thank you. Yeah, so that might be another way to solve the Majorana problem.
Yeah, I was just thinking about that, yeah.
Right. And notice that we still had Majorana fermions in the sense that we were doing of combining things to get things that were invariant under conjugation. So
if I can have a look at that and maybe
of course.
Have some idea on
that. That was one of the reasons why I tried to write everything down. So
that would be good. But another thing I'll mention that is my understanding of space is that it really uses, without us realizing, it's using non-standard analysis when we use
new
space.
Infinitesimal.
Yeah, and that's
nilpotent
infinitesimals
as well. Mm-hmm. You've got a second paper that you want to present. You know, forget that quarter an hour that I asked for.
We can do that now if you want.
Well, what do you want to do now?
I was going to give you, it'll be quite different. I'm going to talk about quaternions.
Yes, because Nick is interested in the quaternion, so can
right.
I think
so? We could do that right now.
Yeah,
put a little magnet across and just